This is USVI News, your Virgin Islands connection.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us for USVI News. I'm Emily Mattson. This week marks 3 months since a UK woman went missing in the territory. Sarm Heslop was last seen on St. John back on March 7th. She has friends and family all over the world working together and hoping they will have answers soon. Our USVI News, Ali Bourne-Vanek, brings us an update.
Family, friends, and loved ones are still searching for answers on what happened to Sarm Heslop, who went missing from a boat in St. John this March. Her friends and family who created the group Find Sarm say, quote, Sarm has... 3-2-1. Her friends and family who created the group Find Sarm say, quote, Sarm has now been missing for 3 months, and the lack of news or information is excruciating for her family and friends back home. We continue to do everything in our power to keep Sarm at the forefront of people's minds, but ultimately, we just want to know what has happened to her, end quote. According to police, Sarm was last seen on March 7th around 10 p.m. Her boyfriend reportedly called 911 around 2:30 a.m. to report her missing. Police said for him to contact the U.S. Coast Guard for a search and rescue mission in case she had fallen overboard his 47-foot catamaran. He reportedly waited about 10 hours to reach out to the Coast Guard. While he hasn't been named a suspect or a person of interest in the case, he has retained an attorney. He also hasn't allowed the police to search his boat. There's a GoFundMe page set up for Sarm, which has raised about $15,000. As everyone was about 3 months ago, they are still searching for answers and hoping for a breakthrough. In St. Thomas, Ali Bourne-Vanek, USVI News.
Thank you, Ali, for that important update. A bomb threat earlier this week forced a resort hotel in St. John to evacuate. On Monday around 10 a.m., VIPD officers responded to the Westin Resort for a bomb threat. Investigators say the resort got a phone call, a male caller telling the staff that a bomb was going to explode on the property. Taking the threat seriously, they evacuated the entire resort as police and fire officials inspected the property. There was no explosive device or material found, so authorities gave the all clear about 5 hours later, around 2:45 Monday afternoon. VIPD are still investigating. A St. Thomas man has turned himself in to police in connection to a deadly hit-and-run crash earlier this week. Tuesday afternoon, 31-year-old Rafael Ledesma German turned himself into officers of the Traffic Bureau of VIPD. He admitted to being the driver of a maroon Acura, which struck and killed 37-year-old Royson Nobaptiste on Brookman Road back on Sunday. He's being charged with leaving the scene of an accident. With bail posted at $7,500, he was placed in prison. VIPD says the deadly accident happened Sunday around 10 p.m. on Brookman Road. The victim was walking across the road when Ledesma German hit him and kept going, according to police. The victim died from his injuries at the hospital. Infrastructure talks continue in Washington this week, and locally, some Caribbean lawmakers are working to make the voice of the territories heard. Our Washington correspondent, Matt Nadler, sits down one-on-one with Virgin Islands Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett to learn more.
But with the new Dems and the infrastructure proposals that you guys want to see, kind of give our viewers a little flavor of that. What is perhaps in this package that you guys want?
Well, I think that what we are looking for, I'm really pleased that the president has decided that infrastructure is not just roads and bridges. He has recognized that infrastructure encompasses a much larger 21st century type of infrastructure, and that includes broadband, but that also includes the things that allow people to go to work. How are we going to support people working? That means job training as well. There's a tremendous amount of money in there, over $100 million specifically for job training. There's over $1 billion for other kinds of rural development and support for that. And so we're excited about the components of the bill that are there to support the American people. And I am going to work as hard as I can on ways and means to make sure that the Virgin Islands is completely included in that. We're really pleased that we've gotten agreement from not only the president's team, but the transportation and infrastructure team in Ways and Means to put the Virgin Islands back into formulas appropriately for our federal highways. That will ensure that the Virgin Islands moves from $16 million to over $40 million per year for our federal roads, which would free up money in other areas. And by roads, that doesn't just include the physical road that we see on the land, but also the federal highway between St. Croix and St. Thomas as well. That's something that I've been talking about since I've come to Congress, and to see it finally at fruition is really a tremendous work. We've also recognized after COVID how important broadband is, and to make sure that the digital divide is shrunk, that, you know, there were so many children in rural areas like the Virgin Islands, or even some in disenfranchised urban areas, that did not receive the type of instruction that they should have because they did not have access to internet. They did not have high-speed internets in their home. And so the president and the House Democrats are working on resolving that on this infrastructure plan as well. And finally, the other area that I think is really important is talking about wealth creation and inclusiveness and equity in this infrastructure plan to ensure that marginalized communities, communities that have not traditionally been able to receive funding for affordable, not just childcare, but homes as well, they're going to be taken care of in this bill, that there are set-asides to get rid of the disparity that has existed in the past. So we know that the Virgin Islands is wrapped in that as well.
I have one quick question on infrastructure that I wanted to ask you, because this was in the new Dems plan, but or at least outlined in the plan. Sustainable infrastructure. I think that is so important for the VI in Puerto Rico, places that have been rebuilding since Hurricanes Maria and Irma. Talk about what sustainable infrastructure looks like. Is that more than, like we talked about, more than just roads and bridges? How does that affect things like the power grid and other types of infrastructure?
Oh, that's a great question. You know, one of the things that the new Dems have really been talking about is building resilient, innovative infrastructure for the future, that as we repair and modernize the nation's infrastructure, we have to build for the future by embracing innovations like high-speed rail, smart technology, specific materials like we did in the Virgin Islands by moving from wooden poles to composite poles and, you know, creating microgrids, putting much more of our utilities underground. But also strengthening communities with preparedness against threats of climate change and supporting expansion of transportation infrastructure. So I'm really pleased that the new Democratic Coalition, which is the largest ideological group of pragmatic Democrats, have a list of bills that they're supporting. And one of those is my bill, H.R. 2053, which is the Resiliency Enhancement Act, which is really about creating infrastructure that's going to not just and not just building for building's sake, but making sure that those buildings are resilient, that they mitigate against the effects of climate change, and even in some instances, reduce congestion and greenhouse gas emissions.
And some important updates from Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett. Thank you, Matt Knadler, for that in-depth interview.